Hello, Professor. I think it's time to start, maybe. Yes.
Hello. Good morning, everybody. It's my pleasure to welcome you to this second lecture in section 16 on control theory and optimization. My name is Monique Laurent, and I'm located in Amsterdam in the Netherlands. It's my great pleasure to introduce Professor Kilu, who is a professor at the School of Mathematics at Sichuan University in China. Professor Kilu has made fundamental contributions to the field of control theory for stochastic distributed parameter systems, typically described by stochastic partial differential equations. In particular, he has discovered several completely new phenomena about controllability and observability, and about inverse systems problems for stochastic evolution equations, thereby establishing for the first time control theory for stochastic distributed parameter systems an independent field. He has also introduced novel concepts and developed a sophisticated theory for the field. As an example, I want to mention his novel stochastic transposition method, which he developed to solve backward stochastic evolution equations and solve and show a Pontryagin-type maximum principle for the optimal control, thereby solving a long-standing difficult problem. This will be part of his lecture today, so I now want to give the floor to Professor Kilu. Professor Kilu, please go ahead. We are looking forward to your lecture.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, thank you very much for the introduction, and it's my great honor to give a talk here. Thanks for the invitation of the IMU. Yes, today I will talk about some recent progress on the stochastic distributed parameter systems. So our first question is, what is the stochastic distributed parameter systems? Usually it means a system governed by a stochastic differential equation in infinite dimensions. Typically, it's by a stochastic partial differential equation. And why should we study the control theory of such kind of systems? I think there are at least two reasons. First is that, motivated by the success of control theories for ordinary differential equations, partial differential equations, and stochastic differential equations, the control theory of stochastic distributed parameter systems is a natural development. Secondly, many important systems are governed by SPDEs. To control them, we have to study the control theory for such kind of systems. And it's worth noting that the birthday of control theory for SPDEs is very close to the one for PDEs and SDEs. It's beginning at the end of the 1960s by some pioneer like the Wendell Fleming and Alan Benhusa. However, the growth rate is much slower and the pace of progress is much heavier. Why? What's the reason for that? In my opinion, there are two reasons. Firstly, the formulation of the stochastic control problems may differ considerably from their deterministic counterparts. Even the formulation of the problem is different, we cannot simply mimic the concepts developed like for PDEs to that for SPDEs. Secondly, is that many effect tools, like work for SDEs and PDEs do not work anymore. As a result, one has to develop new mathematical tools, even for some very simple SPDEs. Now, we should focus on the control. You say control like a word has different meaning, but here we mean that control is to modify the behavior of a system to achieve a desired goal by a suitable actions in an optimal way. You see here, we have two important words. One is to achieve a desired goal. Another is we want to do that in optimal way. This leads to two fundamental issues in control theory. One is controllability, which corresponds to whether we can achieve a desired goal. The another is optimal control. That means we want to control the system in an optimal way. And today I will focus on recent progress on these two issues. First, we see the controllability problems. It's well known that different PDEs enjoy different controllability properties. And there are so many SPDEs. Today, due to the limitation of time, I only explain one typical SPDE, that is the stochastic wave equation. But before go to that equation, we first report controllability for ODEs to say, what's the meaning of controllability? Consider the following ODE. You say this is almost the simplest control systems. And what's the means of exact controllability? You say for this system, that means from the initial point y0, we can find a control such that the solution of the equation at time capital T equal to y1. That means we use a control to drive the state of the system to a given destination. How to study that controllability problems? People invented the duality argument. They introduced the following ODE and proved that the exact controllability of the control system is equivalent to the following observability estimate for the ODE system 2.2. You say, by this, we convert a controllability problem for an equation problem. And more precisely, we will say whether a controllability problem, that means whether we can drive the state of the system to achieve a desired destination, to whether an inequality holds. This is a pure equation problem. And by this reduction, we can prove that the system 2.1 is exactly controllable if and only if the following famous Carleman rank condition holds. And more importantly, we can say that if the system 2.1 is exactly controllable, then we can choose control which is analytical in time variable. Now we go to the stochastic setting. Now we have a complete filtered probability space on which a one-dimensional Brown machine is defined, and F is the natural filtration of W. This is very important, F is the natural filtration. We will say that several times. And now we consider the simplest generalization of the ODE system, the 2.4. You say this is nothing but an ODE perturbed by a multiplicative noise. We say this system is exactly controllable if for any destination y belongs to this space. This is a space constituted by random variables. And we can find a control, adaptive control, such that the solution fulfills yt equal to y capital T. You say different from the ODE setting. Here, the destination is random variables and the control we choose are adapted. Why? Why we change the formulation? The reason is as follows. First, the rule belong to the adapted stochastic process means that one can only utilize the information known at time t. We cannot use the information in future due to the stochastic setting. There's uncertainty. We cannot predict what will happen in future. So we can only use information we can observe that is at time t. You can only use information you can observe at time t. Second is that the state space. This is simply because for the SDE system, this is the natural state space. If we mean exact controllability, we want to achieve every possible point in the state space. Unfortunately, in 1994, Professor Peng Shige proved that the system 2.4 is not exact controllable for any choice of M. So there are two, you say, possible ways, yeah, to say how to use this negative result. One is we should modify the definition of exact controllability, but unfortunately, the above definition is a natural one and it's reduced by many practical applications. It's also related to optimal control theory. So we should keep the definition. Then what can we do? Our way is like this. We use more control. Yeah. You say now, not all the BU, but BV are two controls. With these two controls, we can prove that system 2.5 is exactly controllable. And we have the following result. You say here is important is that rank D should be, the rank of D should be equal to N. Is this result a travel corollary of theorem one? Yes. You say if the rank of D is equal to N, one may find the following proof. That is, we choose way in the feedback form. And then by this choice of way, we say the diffusing term disappear and we get a ODE. Can we regard the simple point omega as a parameter and to find the to get the exact controllability of the system 2.6? The answer is no. The reason is that we should use AF adapted controls. If we use the above argument, we can prove the control you used is not the AF adapted one. That means to design the control, you use information in future. This is forbidden. Another choice is maybe we can use some irregular control and we prove that if the control belongs to L1 and the rank of B is N, then we can not employ the control DV. Then we prove that if we choose control in LP for any P larger than one, the system is not exactly controllable. This means what? Means the control will be very rough if we only put the control in the drift term. Remember that for the ODE case, our control can be analytic, but here it must be L1 and cannot be any LP. Secondly, is the rank B equal to N is also necessary. Otherwise, we can prove there are some components cannot be controlled. Now, after these preliminaries, which gives, I think, the audience some impressions on the difference between the controllability for ODE and SDE, now we turn to the stochastic wave equation. You say first we introduce like the domain. The equation is on this domain with a C2 boundary gamma, and the gamma zero is a subset of the boundary. We consider the following simple list controlled stochastic wave equation. You say in this wave equations, we use three controls, the red one, F, G, and H. The definition of the exact controllable is very similar for the one for SDEs. That is, we should use adapted controls to drive the state of the system to a desired random variables. You say the controls are the strongest possible ones that can be introduced to the system. We put the control everywhere, in the drift term, in the diffusing term, and on the whole boundary. So one may guess that the exact controllability of this system has to be correct traveling, right? We try our best to put the controls. Unfortunately, this is wrong. The system 2.8 is not exactly controllable. Yeah, even we put these so strong controls. And motivated by the negative result, we consider a refined stochastic wave equation. You say this is like the SDE case. The original system is not exactly controllable and people modify the models. Here, the situation is the same. These wave equation, they are derived by some physicists. They use that to describe the, very scale, small scale strings and membranes. But we find that from the viewpoint of controllability, this is not a good model. We introduce another model like this one. Here, we still use three controls here like F, G, and H. Our goal is the same. We use the adaptive control to drive the state to some desired runtime variables. You see. We use three controls. For people who are familiar with the controllability formula for deterministic wave equations, they may think that, you use too many controls. However, we can prove that none of them can be ignored. And more importantly is that both F and G should be put everywhere on the domain. You say for people work for the controllability of deterministic PDEs, if you told him your control should be put everywhere on the domain, he will think, no, this will be meaningless. On one hand, if you put a control everywhere for deterministic equations, then the controllability problem will be trivial. You can prove that very easy. On the other hand, if you put a control everywhere, then your control system is useless. For example, if you want to control the temperature of a room, if you put a control everywhere, means that your air conditioner should occupy the whole space of the room. You say such a kind of control system is useless. But for the stochastic PDEs, the situation is quite different. On one hand, even F and G are put everywhere on the whole domain, the result is not trivial mathematically. On the other hand, if the control is put everywhere in the diffusion term, such kind of control can be, used for practical systems. Yeah. So this is the main difference between deterministic PDEs and stochastic PDEs, neither the mathematically or in the for practical system. Yes, and moreover, I show that our conclusion, that means the three controls must be put on the system, is guaranteed by the following result. This result shows us if F is supported in a proper subset of G, then the system is not exactly controllable. The same happens to G, and the boundary control must be put. Even we show that three controls are necessary and F and G must put everywhere on the domain, people maybe think the controllability result is trivial. You say they can use the following proof. They choose F and G in the feedback form to get rid of the diffusion term, and then they get a wave equation with runtime parameters. Then can we regard the sample point as a parameter? That means for every given sample point, we find the control depends on this parameter to achieve the following identity. However, we also can prove that the control chosen in this way is not adapted. That means the control you constructed in this way use the information in future implicit. Yeah, this is forbidden in the stochastic settings. And how to prove the controllability result? Similar to the ODE case, we introduced this joint equation. Now it's a backward stochastic wave equation. We introduced this joint equation and we prove that the exact controllability is equivalent to the following observability. This is also a priori estimate for this equation, 2.11. That means whether the stochastic wave equation is exactly controllable just depends on whether this a priori estimate holds. And how to prove this? How to prove the 2.12? You say there are three main approaches to establish observability estimate for deterministic wave equations. The first and the second one are multiplier technique and the method of propagation of singularities. They work well for deterministic wave equations with time-independent coefficients. But until now, it's unknown whether they can be applied to handle stochastic problems. The third one is based on the global Carleman estimate. This one can be generalized to studies observability estimate for SPDEs. And how do we apply the Carleman estimate? It's based on the following pointwise identity. Yeah, this identity looks very complex, but in the spirit of Carleman estimate, it's very simple. You say here, this term comes from the equation. We use some function multiplier with this equation, and then we get lots of term, but only the three red one and this one are important. You say this three one, we call that energy term. In Carleman estimate, we should choose L here. We just say for any function in the form of exponential L, we have this identity. The next step is that we should choose L smart to keep this term as a good sign. This should be positive with a large parameter. This term can absorb the other terms. We call that lower order terms. And this guy is a boundary observation give us, which corresponds to the boundary controls. Once such kind of identity is established, what we should do is try to find an L. And this usually was constructed under the guidelines of Homander's pseudo convex condition. Yeah, for our special case, for the stochastic wave equations, we just design a pseudo convex function and to get the desired Carleman estimate, and then we can get the observability estimate. Further, I want to remark that although this identity looks very complex, the derivation of it is very simple. We just apply Edo's formula to this term, and then by integration, some Leibniz formula, yeah, and we try to find the energy term, and then the all other terms we just keep it and to find L to help us to get rid of them. Now we turn to the optimal control problems. Like the controllability problems, there are lots of useful tools for optimal control problems. Today I only focus on the Pontryagin-type maximum principle. Also, I began with the following example of ODE system to say what is the Pontryagin maximum principle. We say consider the following ODE system. And now we choose a control in a set. Here is that take values in a separable matrix space. Now this is just not the mathematicians want to make the system very complex. The reason is that U is a separable metric space comes from the practical problems. Like if you use the air conditioner to control the temperature of your house, you only have some discrete choice, like 60 centigrade, 11, yeah, something like 16, 11, 18, 19. Yeah, you cannot choose the temperature as a irrational number. Yeah, that means only some discrete point. So we write it as a separable metric space. This is very important. We will see that this. And once you say we have U, we can solve this ODE and to get X. And our we have a cost functional in the following form. The boards are typed. This has an F and the H at the final time. our goal is to minimize this cost of function. Any control rule which minimizes the cost of function noise is called an optimal control. And the corresponding solution, you say once the rule is given, we can solve the equation. It's called an optimal state. And when we put X bar, U bar together, we call it an optimal pair. Now, our problem is how to find the optimal pair. You say, motivated by the calculus, in the theory of calculus, how do we find a minimal point of a function? We compute its derivative. We say the if the derivative of the function is equal to zero, so this point is maybe the minimum point. That means we find a necessary condition to what's the minimal point. For the optimal control, Pontryagin follow the same idea. They say that maybe we compute the derivative of the cost functional with respect to the perturbation of u to say what will happen. And to do this, at that point, u does not necessarily have a linear structure. So a perturbation like u bar plus delta u is meaningless. There, people use the following spike variation. You say they find the mega measurable state, and then they perturb the optimal control rule. In the A epsilon, they choose it to be another control, and in other state, it's the optimal control. This is the so-called spike variation. With aid of this spike variation, we can compute the difference between the cost functional. One is the optimal control, another is the perturbed control. Here, the y epsilon is what? Y epsilon is the state with of the linearized version of the state corresponding to the perturbed control. That means now we compute this guy and we say, three, since u bar is an optimal control, so this guy must be larger than zero. This can be used as a necessary condition, but it's not sharp enough. You say this is true, but it's useless. Next step, what should we do? We should get rid of the y epsilon. You say here, we have this guy is not very good. To do that, we introduce the following ODE. We call that also the adjoint equation. By this equation, we just simply use the differential chain. We will see the following identity. Remember that our difference of the cost functional is the following. You say the red part is the same. We can use 3.6 and this term to get rid of the red part. And we only keep this part, which is independent of the y epsilon. And for this, we will get this so-called Pontryagin maximum principle. You say it tells us what? It tells us any optimal control for almost every key, it must maximize the function h defined as follows. This is the powerful of Pontryagin maximum principle. The original optimal control problem is an optimization problem of a function, but with the aid of Pontryagin maximum principle, it's reduced to what? It's reduced to an optimization problem of a function. You say this is very important. It's reduced to an infinite dimensional optimization problem to a finite dimensional optimal problem. Recall that there are two key points in establishing Pontryagin maximum principle. So first is to compute the tiny expansion. This depends on the estimate of the equation. For different type of control system, we should use estimate for different equations. Like for ODEs, the first order is enough. For SDEs, since the following fact, we have to compute a second order tangent expansion. The first problem for the tangent expansion is a technical problem. The second one, we need some new idea. That's about the adjoint equation. You say for the ODE case, we need an ODE with final data. This does not introduce any difficulty. Since for an ODE, you give the initial data or the final data, it's the same. But for stochastic setting, for an SDE, if you give the final data, what's the meaning? This problem was answered first by Jean-Michel Bismuth and then by Pardo and Peng. Yeah, they introduced the backward stochastic differential equation and established the stochastic maxima principle for SDEs. Let's recall it briefly. Recall that we have the probability space and the filtration is the natural one. And now we choose adapted control. And the SDE is the 3.7. Our cost functional is the same, only we take the mathematical expectation. And our goal is also to minimize the cost function. You see, now we still do the spike variation. Yeah, this is the perturbed control system. And do the tangent expansion, as I said, we need a second order expansion. You will say, compare with the deterministic one, all the red one comes from due to the stochastic setting. Now we should get rid of these ones. First, we show why, what's the terms, y epsilon and z epsilon in here. Here we have y and z. These are the equation for them. To get rid of them, we introduce the adjoint equation. This one is to get rid of y. It's like the adjoint equation for the deterministic case. The second one is not for z. It's in the following form. I want to emphasize that this is a matrix valued equation. The first one is a vector valued equation. Second one is a matrix valued equation. Yeah. And then you introduce the H. You say here, this part is similar to the deterministic part, and the red one is to handle the uncertainty. With them, they can prove the stochastic matrix maximum principle. It also reduces an optimization problem for functional to optimization problem to a function. There should be two natural generalizations of the above stochastic maximum principle. The first one is that in that result, they assume the filtration is the natural one generated by the Brown machine. That means there is no other source of uncertainty. Second one is for SDE. Can we generalize it to SPDEs? To do that, we meet two main handicaps. First one is that we should solve the adjoint equation like a BSD on general filtration. Recall that to prove the well-posed list of BSD on the natural filtration of the Brown machine, people use the martingale representation theorem. This is a key step. On the general filtration, we do not have such kind of result. And the second one is that you say we introduce two adjoint equations. The second one is a matrix valued one. In finite dimensional, a matrix valued one can always be regarded as a vector valued one, but in infinite dimensional, it will be an operator valued one. There's no stochastic integration theory, in general Banach space that can be employed to treat such equations. Yes, overcome these difficulties, we introduce the so-called stochastic transposition method to give a weaker but reasonable definition to this vector-valued backward stochastic evolution equation and the operator-valued one. First, we say how to do that for the vector-valued one. Now, our probability space, the filtration is not the natural one generated by the Brown machine. That means there are some other source of uncertainty. And we assume H is the Hilbert space and A is the generator of a series zero semigroup on it. Consider the following one. You say for this equation, since there is no martingale representation theorem, we cannot understand it as an integral equation. How to define the solution to it? This is the first from question we should answer. Recall that for forward equation, the well posedness of it does not depend on the filtration. So the equation 3.15 is always makes sense. And we call the Y and the capital Y the pair of stochastic process or transposition solution for the backward one if the following identity holds. Why we introduce such kind of definition? It's like this. If the backward one has a weak solution, then by Edo's formula, we get 3.15. So it's a generalization of the classical weak solution of backward equation. Secondly, is that this is enough for our goal to establish the Pontryagin-type maximum principle. Due to these two reasons, we introduce this definition and we prove that it really admits a unique transposition solution. The key points in the proof is that first, we use a Ritz type representation theorem to find the stochastic process. Secondly, we generalize the Lebesgue differential theorem and some martingale theorem to show the regularity of the solutions. Now we turn to the operator valued one. The equation is in the following form. It seems that we should follow the idea of the vector one, then we should introduce a forward equation, and the forward equation should take values in all the T1H. That means the space constituted of all trace class operators. Unfortunately, this space is also not a UMD bar space. There's no suitable stochastic integration theory on it. So we cannot mimic the vector one to our operator one. And we introduce the following definition. We introduce two equations. Both of them are H valued. These equations are well posed. And we say a pair of operator valued process are transposition solution to the backward one if the following identity holds. And the space, I do not want to pay attention to this space. You just think they are the largest one for this equality makes sense. And the reason for us to use this in definition is the same. First, if the backward one has solution, then by Edo's formula, we get this one. Secondly, this identity is enough for us to establish the Pontryagin-type maximum principle. However, the well-posedness of the equation is still open. We can only show the uniqueness. We know it admits at most one, but we cannot prove the existence. The reason is that in our definition, the characterization of the term Q is very weak. This term is not a core sign. We cannot get a good estimate from this identity for Q. So this definition seems reasonable, but until now, we don't know how to prove the well-posedness. So we try to find a weaker one. That is, we call that relaxed transposition solution. Remember that in our definition, the characterization of Q is very weak. For P, it's okay. For Q, it's very weak. So we should introduce some space that the characterization of Q is even weaker. So we introduce this space. And we say a triple of process, the relaxed transposition solution is the following identity holds. You say recall that in the definition of transposition solution, the identity we is for Q is this term. And now we cannot show Q up operator value, the pointwise process. They are in a more weaker form. Now, this is the definition of the relaxed transposition solution. Fortunately, this is enough for establishing the Pontryagin maximum principle. Yeah. And we have the well-posed list. For the relaxed transposition solution, we can show the existence. And now we recall, go to the control problems. It's the same. Now it's for an stochastic PDE. You say here A is the generator of C0 semigroup. We want to minimize this cost functional. Yes. And the definition like optimal control, optimal pair is almost the same. Now we introduce H in the following form. If X bar U bar is an optimal pair and Y is a transposition solution for the vector value equation and the trap point is a relaxed transposition solution in the following setting, then we get that the Pontryagin maximum principle in the form of 3.25. The spin rate is the same. We reduce an optimization of a functional to an optimization of a function. And now you find that a key point is that the term Q does not appear in the final form. So although our characterization of Q is weaker, but it's enough. However, if we want to like do something like second order, you say in optimization, once we have first order necessary condition, we want to search second order sufficient condition, which can help us to design some algorithm. We can get like the convergence. Then for that case, we really need Q. The relaxed transposition solution is not enough. We need the original definition of the transposition solution to give a second order sufficient condition. Yes, which I think is very important. But unfortunately, until now, we don't know how to prove that. You say in this talk, I just give typical example for the recent results for control theory of stochastic distributed parameter systems due to the limitation of time. But I suggest there are some recently, like the first in the book, a joint work with Professor Xu Zhang. We put the recent results for this topic. And we also put many open problems on that. People knew will say the recent progress, like the controllability, besides the stochastic wave equation, you will say for stochastic heat equation, stochastic Schrodinger equation, and stochastic transport equation. And for the optimal control problem, you will say some other like the linear quadratic or optimal control problems. And the another one is the recent survey papers published in last year. You will find that there are lots of open problems, lots of interesting and challenging problems. Yeah, and I said that so control theory for SDPS is still in its infant time. It is desired to be studied. Okay, that's all. Thank you.
Okay, so let me take the last few seconds to thank very much Professor Ki Lu for his beautiful and inspiring lecture. Thanks also for giving this source of information. And I recall that the slides of your lecture will be available on the ICM website. So thank you very much and have a good day. Yes. And also have a good day to the whole participants who are online. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Come, goodbye.